Center for Medieval and Renaissance Studies, and I'm very glad to welcome you here for a special lecture by a special person. I want to thank the School of International Letters and Cultures for making this possible, particularly Professor Stephen West, who has been in contact with Professor Geary and made all the arrangements, but also the School of History, Philosophy, and Religious Studies, and minor contributions from ACMRS. There are just three things you need to know about Professor Patrick Geary. One is he's Professor of Medieval History at the Institute for Advanced Studies in Princeton. Second, his works have been translated into German, French, Italian, Portuguese, Slavonian, Romanian, Serbian, Turkish, Japanese, Korean, and my favorite, Albanian. Now, these two facts are important for two reasons. One, the Institute for Advanced Studies is arguably the most prestigious and important think tank in the world. An appointment at that institute is equivalent to an appointment in Nirvana, or not Valhalla, because you'd be dead now, but an appointment there indicates that you are a stellar researcher and professor, and that indeed is Pat Geary. I don't have time to list all his publications. That would take up the entire hour, or his list of awards from Guggenheim to American Council of Learned Society to many, many others. The third thing that's important to know about him is that the future of the Middle Ages and Renaissance is in his hands. Now, let me be more specific about that. 2 years ago, Pat and I participated in a conference at UCLA on the future of the Middle Ages and Renaissance, and a number of directors of centers for medieval and Renaissance studies around the world and professors who are in influential institutes such as the Institute for Advanced Studies were invited there to talk about that problem. And that's when I first saw the preliminary stages of the research he's about to present tonight. His work on DNA struck all of us as an indication of what really must happen in the humanities in general and medieval and Renaissance studies in particular, in yoking what we have to offer as humanists to what scientists have to offer as scientists in order to help solve some of the more complex problems in the world, such as poverty, obesity, the high rate of physician suicide, the deleterious effect of climate change. All these kinds of things can only be solved by a fruitful collaboration and interdisciplinary collaboration between the humanities and sciences. And that's why I'm particularly thrilled that he will be presenting his research here tonight on DNA and the migration problem. So please welcome Professor Patrick Geary.
Thank you very much. I have a cold, so I can't hear myself. Can you hear me?
That's okay.
Did you turn off the spotlights so we can see the screen?
Yes, there should be a way to kill. Can we kill the spots? Is that okay? No, that's is that all right?
That's bad.
Okay, and this, and if you fall asleep, that's fine, just don't fall out of the chair and hurt yourself. It's a real pleasure to be here and to be able to talk with you today about a project that I have been directing for a number of years that is not as far along as I wish it were for reasons that I think will be clear, but I think that I hope that it has a potential to be of use. We're not going to solve all the problems that Professor Coor suggested. We're not going to deal with physician suicide, global warming, change the world. One issue we are dealing with is how to understand migration as a European phenomenon. Right now, Europe is facing a crisis, a refugee crisis, it's a migration crisis, and for re- reasons that all tied up with European identity, people look to the past to understand the present. I'm not sure that that's a good idea, but we who work with the past have to come to terms with these issues. And what I'm going to begin talking about is a map that has nothing to do with the Middle Ages, and that's this. Very fine geneticist at the University of Chicago, who was a colleague of mine when I was at UCLA, produced this map. This is a map of modern DNA in Europe, simply taking samples from a modern DNA database of several thousand people and using principal component analysis, reducing the great complexity of thousands of points on the, on each individual genome to plot to a simple XY axis. And the letters indicate the location from which that person and that person's family came. And it's just sort of a blur, but if you look at this map, and this map was not generated geographically, it's simply genetic distance separating each individual from each other individual. And if we overlay this blob on the map of Europe, it turns out that you can actually recognize the geographical structure of Europe simply by looking at the genetic distance separating Europeans. You can recognize Scandinavia, you can see Central Europe, you can see the Italian peninsula, you see the Iberian peninsula. This is not produced by any geographic evidence whatsoever. It's simply how close people are to each other. His conclusion, which got him a MacArthur last year, was that people have sex with people that they're physically close to. he didn't quite put it that way. That's why I don't have a MacArthur, he does. The genetic distance, that it's geographic distance that is the primary determinant of genetic distance. So what one has is a very static map of Europe. It's a recognizable map of Europe. What you don't have are isolates. Even when you drill down at a much finer level, you don't have people out of place. The only ones who are a little bit out of place are Sardinians, who are a very special group, and people from the Basque Country. Otherwise, people belong mapped to where they should be geographically. It's not language, it's not ethnicity. In particular, what we don't see are evidence of isolates that suggest population movements, large groups of people wandering around Europe. What we see is that people fit geographically where they should be. It seems to be a very isolated, a static image of Europe. And yet we know, or we're told, that Europe has been a migration destination since the Paleolithic. Where is movement in John November's map? And movement as a medieval historian is something that is very important to me and to others who study the early Middle Ages because of the long tradition that we have been told about called in German the Völkerwanderung, which means the wandering of peoples, or for Italians and French, the barbarian invasions. The mass movement of populations from the north and the east into the Roman Empire between the 4th and the end of the 6th centuries, which has been credited with the destruction of the Roman Empire or refreshing the population of a tired empire with new blood and vigorous people, depending on whether you see yourself as the descendant of the invader or of the invadee. Well, the barbarian invasions have been a motif in European history since really the late 18th century. This is not necessarily the way Europeans have understood their past forever, but it's been a basic part of the explanation of the transformation of the Roman world, the end of the Roman world, formation of Europe at the end of antiquity. But what actually happened in this period? And this is something that historians have been debating for centuries. And there are people like Brian Mark Perkins at Oxford who said, yep, they were barbarian invasions. And he has a book called The End of Rome, the Fall of Rome and the End of Civilization. The barbarians destroyed the Roman Empire. Rome didn't fall, it was pushed. It was pushed by barbarians. His colleague in London talks about incursions rather than invasions. Yes, they mess things up, they come in, it's not quite as bad as Brian suggests. Brian's calling wrong, so he has a real identity there. But then you've got a German like Picard Borgold who says there are really no invasions. There are diffusions. There's a Slavic diffusion, there's a Frankish diffusion, but we shouldn't talk about invasions. And then there are people like Guy Halsall in Europe who says invasion, diffusion. No, they're civil wars. They're civil wars in which there are military units recruited from the frontiers. And these military units, used by different factions in the Roman world in their civil wars as federated troops, are part of, but only part of, a very complicated story. But there are no barbarian invasions. This did not happen. There are no big population changes at the end of the ancient world. Well, so what's a poor historian or the public to say? Well, who's right? Do we have barbarian invasions? Do we have some diffusions? Do we just have civil wars with, you know, a few elites, military units coming into an area, taking over, kind of coup d'etat, and population doesn't change, society doesn't change, but the political leadership changes? Why, we're paid to be professional historians, why can't we answer this question? And I think we can agree, first of all, because our written evidence is inadequate. Secondly, our archaeological evidence is ambiguous. And third, we're all still caught in issues of modern ideology. So, written records, for example. This is the only exactly contemporaneous account of the Lombard invasion. If we'll get back to the Lombards, we'll be talking about the so-called Lombards the rest of the time. So, in 568, in this year, 568, supposedly King Alcuin takes people into Italy. The Latin text says, in this year, King Alcuin, King of the Lombards, with his army, leaving and burning Pannoni, that's what it's today, Hungary, Austria, that region, along with their women and children and all of his people, occupy Italy and Fara. And there, some perish by disease, some by famine, a few by the sword. And then in that year, they presumed to enter the frontiers of Gaul, where a multitude of the captives of this people were for sale. Well, that's our only contemporary text that is written by someone who presumably has direct knowledge. There one other text from a bishop in Gaul and what is today southern France, but this is the one primary text. But what does it say? First of all, in Fara, we don't know what that means. Or a lot of people say, oh, we know what it means, but they don't agree, so we're not really sure. Is it by family group, by military group, what is a Fara? Much discussion. But they invade, okay, they burn their place and everybody, he burns their houses, they can't come back, everybody goes in, all in one year, a big mass migration. And some perish by disease, by famine, and by the sword. Well, who are these some? The Latin, for those of you who are classicists or medievalists, says, alle infame non nulli gladio brutti. Idique alle immorbo alle infame non nulli gladio brutti. So the alleis, but those, some of them, has to refer to somebody who's already been mentioned. Who's been mentioned? Well, the Longobards. So it sounds like they invaded Italy and they died. They invaded Italy. Some died by the sword, some died by famine, some died by disease. This is the period of Black Death, incidentally, the so-called Justinianic Plague. So it looks like they failed, except that we have Lombardy today. And there was a Lombard kingdom in it. So how will we understand that? We don't really know. Did he just write this before the war was over? Did he get his information wrong? Are we interpreting the text wrong? Is his Latin not as good as modern philologists? We don't know. Archaeology. Who were the Lubbers? Well, up in the North Sea, in the lower Elbe region, from the first century, Roman ethnographers say, oh, they're the Longobardi, the Longbeards live up there. Then they completely disappear from the written record. There's a material culture up there. We don't know much about it. They use cremation rather than burials, so you can't say very much about this culture. But then after 300 years, suddenly in what is today Southern Czech Republic region of Moravia, we begin to see a characteristic type of archaeology. Which texts, like the one we saw before, and other later texts say, oh, the Lombards were there. So we, and one of the typical things are these S-shaped brooches, these pens, these in this font. Then a few years later, we find them around Budapest and toward the Vienna Woods, similar thing. And then they show up in Italy. Ah, now we can trace the Lombard migration by looking at this type of object buried in graves, which would be great, except that we also find these brooches in down the lower Rhone Valley, northern Germany, all kinds of places where no text has ever said that there were any Lombards. So can we really say that these objects are proof of a population movement, or is this a fashion? Is this a type of jewelry worn by a certain kind of cultural group, regardless of who they thought they were, regardless of political identity, that this is just something you find throughout this world in the course of the 6th century? The material culture shows cultural change, but it does not show population change. So we have ambiguous texts that describe this, but in obscure ways, or that much later. We have a very detailed account that tells how they came from northern Germany all the way down through this region. It's written 200 years later. Can we really believe that? And then the other problem is modern ideology. One historian says if Europe falls, it will fall because, like ancient Rome, it does not believe in the superiority of its civilization. It believes that cultures are equal, so multiculturalism. And he describes what's happening to Europe today as exactly what happens in the 5th and 6th century. Or another person talking about the contemporary migration crisis in Europe. Without any action, this migration influx will be like the barbarian invasion of the 4th century, and the consequences will be the same. This is Geert Wilders, the head of the extreme right populist party in the Netherlands, and Marine Le Pen, the head of the National Front in France. This is the barbarian invasions all over again. Well, we can say, no, it's not the barbarian invasion, but it's something. But what were the barbarian invasions? How do we come to terms with this? How do we tend to think historically as human beings. We take what we know from the past to understand the present, but we don't really understand that past. So is it the same, is it different? Well, it's certainly very, very different, but what was the past in the first place? So how do we figure this out? What alternatives? If we have bad written form, ambiguous written evidence, ambiguous archaeological evidence, how do we cut through the ideological fog? Go to genetics, and today everybody's excited about genetics. Tell us who you really are. You are your genes. This is a modern scientist fallacy. A scientific fallacy. I don't think scientists necessarily believe this, but the idea that somehow our genes are the core of our identity is very, very popular. How many of you have set off a mouth swab and to get your genetic background? Let's be honest here. Yeah, sure. And you found out who you really are. Does that change who you are to have that evidence? Some people it does. But does that knowledge inform how you live, who you do? It's something that is an issue in society today. And it has become very popular recently to try to say, okay, we're going to cut through the fog of historical documents, these historians with their musty manuscripts and their old Latin text. Science is going to give us the answer. Well, Not sure that's going to work, but maybe it can help us a little bit. So we're going to approach identity through genetics. There are problems here. First of all, what genes? My colleague John November takes modern DNA, which makes a lot of sense. Or should you look at old DNA? You have to dig up people. Modern DNA is readily available. There's probably some of it right here in this room. It's in excellent condition. It's very easy to do a whole genome reconstruction of everybody here. This is industrially done. You can do this. You can get your entire genome sequence very cheaply and without trouble. It's relatively cheap. But if we're going to try to study the past using modern DNA, first of all, we're assuming that the individual sample of the descendants of people we're trying to study. Well, the fact that you had four grandparents in the same village in the 20th century, does that guarantee that 15 generations ago, your family was there? If you don't believe in history, you say, sure, it's always been that way. But maybe history involves population movements that we don't know about. It may be migration for work. It may involve slavery. It may involve periods of contraction in society, bottlenecks when a lot of people die out there. So the assumption, you go back 100 years and you could go all the way back to the beginning, may be true, but it's a leap of faith. They said that no genetic drift, a small group, somebody has 10 kids and their kids have 10 kids, and pretty soon they're pushing out the alternative genetic population. And even if it's true that these people's genetics go back to, say, the 6th century, you're really only studying the winners. It doesn't say what the 6th century looked like. It says what part of the 6th century happens, for whatever weird reasons, to have survived to today. If you're a physician, you're interested in hereditary diseases, that's fine. You don't care about the people who died out. But if you want to know who came into Italy in the 6th century, even if their genetics are not present in the modern Italian community, you still want to understand the past as the past, not simply its relation to the present. Fine. So we'll use ancient DNA. We'll dig them up. Well, it's hard. First of all, you've got to dig them up. And you have to extract them, which is a nightmare, because it begins to degrade at depth. It's not lightly contaminated, it's always contaminated with every organic matter that ever came into contact with it, bacteria in the bones, every rat that ran across the grave, every archaeologist that handled the bone. It is definitely contaminated. Some bones don't have any DNA in them, so you can spend a lot of money and get nothing. I've spent a lot of money to get nothing. But at least you're sampling the population you want to study. You're not using proxies. If you can get material, then you're actually getting data from that population and not assume 15 generations later. So hard, expensive, difficult, partial, frustrating, but in my sense, the only way to do it. But then what DNA do you want? You know that the mitochondria is that inherited from your mother's mother, 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 back to Eve, or back to beyond that to a bacterium that somehow got inside of this organ. Or part of the Y chromosome that is father, 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 all the way back. Particularly mitochondria is the best, is the easiest to obtain and to study in many, many studies, including parts of our own have worked with mitochondria, because there are lots and lots of copies of the mitochondria in every cell. So if something's going to survive, you have a good chance it'll be that. And so they mostly concentrate on the mitochondria, or that portion of the Y chromosome that that does not recombine in every generation. That's fine. It's abundant. But they let you extrapolate. You can do certain mathematically who was the most recent common ancestor of these people, and thus determine the kinship, or not kinship, but closest relationship within a community by finding the most recent common ancestor as these populations have descended. But it's only a very small part of one's genetic history. You have one mother and one father, you have four grandparents, you have eight great-grandparents, and it goes on geometrically. So you're getting a very, very small picture of a population, because most of your DNA is recombinant. It can combine, break apart and recombine in every generation. That's where most of our genetic heritage comes from. All the richness and the complexity is there. If we look at mitochondria, Y chromosome, we have this idea of a single uninterrupted line, which is great for identity politics. I'm a descendant of Charlemagne, or everyone in Asia descendant of Genghis Khan, or whatever. But what about all the other ancestors? What about all the other admixtures and combinations that make us who we are? That's washed out. That's not really telling us about the complexity of human society. So we should look at nuclear DNA. There is an enormous more data, an enormous amount of data in that part of the nucleus that recombines in every generation. It gives us our whole genetic background, and not just our father or our mother. Go beyond haplogroups, and you probably have haplogroups, those of you who had your DNA, they say, well, you have these haplogroups that make up your, you can really get to a very fine grain background. Very, very expensive, very difficult, particularly with ancient DNA. Very hard to do. And it presents major computational problems. If there are over 3 billion places on the genome, each one theoretically can have its own genealogy with recombination. So while you can work back to the most recent common ancestor, its mitochondria, if you have 3 billion genealogical tables that you have to work back for an individual, you have a population of several thousand people, then the computation is something that biostatistics has not yet figured out how to do. This becomes one of these big data problems that NSA and others are very interested in trying to crack. How do we do these computations? Frankly, we don't yet know the best way to approach this. And this is something that some of the mathematicians at the Institute for Advanced Study are very interested in, applying very different kinds of mathematics to try to look at the incredible complexity of genetic relatedness within the nuclear DNA. Now, what have people been doing? Well, there's some old studies about mitochondria, about DNA that I need to talk about. This is the Stone Age of historical genetic research. Some more interesting work, two people at USC, of course I was at UCLA, so people at USC are suspect, but very good scientists looking at identity by descent of portions of the nuclear DNA. It's a nuclear DNA study that thinks that they think that by the amount of the segment that is inherited together, and it doesn't, not every point breaks apart in every generation, that you can even see sort of a clock, and they think you can go back in these 500-year tranches and see European population changing. So these are maps of population with identity by descent portions of the nuclear DNA. They did very, very sophisticated genetic work using modern DNA, and then they got a history textbook and they looked it up, and the Huns did it. It's all about the Huns. So bringing historians in at the end, not even bringing, started bringing in some general textbooks, flipping through and saying, oh, well, it looks like around 500 something's going on. It must be the hunt. We historians get nervous about that. Another more recent study, Busby and all, on admixtures in European population. Again, nuclear DNA, but again, using modern DNA, looking at possible, trying to argue about possible population movements within layers by admixture of different DNA groups, and turns out it's not the Huns at all, it's the Slavs. That's fine. It's important path-breaking genetics. It's lousy history because they don't know anything about the complexity of the past. They are, as one person has put it, making up stories to explain their data. So it's modern data, there's no collaboration, simplistic assumptions about population movements and migrations, seeing whole populations wandering off. If we look historically at migrations, who migrates? Who migrates?
Men.
Men. How old?
Young.
Young men migrate. Yes, there's some women, but young men on the move. Well, if young men are on the move, we're going to look at mitochondria. We're not going to learn a lot about their wives and their children, are we, if they're picking up women along the way. So the simplistic model, also does one move, it's chain migration. One person gets there, he writes home and says, hey, it's pretty good here, join us. He may go back home for a while. He may come back. He may be there, he may have a family. We know some of the Goths had Gothic wives back home, and they had wives in the Roman Empire. They kind of go back and forth. Not unknown to that. So what we've tried to do is create a project, a test project, to try to do it a little bit better. Now, we're saying these are lumber ones. Why? Why lumber? We don't know that they're lumber. This is a label in written texts that talk about a political organization that historically appears above the Danube around 500. The name means Longbeard. If there's any relationship with the Longbeards of the first century, hundreds of miles to the north, we don't know. Maybe they like the name. Maybe it's a coincidence. We have absolutely no idea. Nor do we know that everybody in this region saw themselves as a lumber. That's a political category, maybe it's a cultural category, not a biological category. But we have texts that talk about this. So we have a model derived from texts like the one that I showed you, a later history of the lumbers written 200 years later. It tells a story. Once upon a time, the little people, they went here, here, here. That's a story. And for a historian, we'd say that that is a model of what some people thought might have happened. At least it's something to test as a hypothesis of a roughly contemporaneous site. Then we have that archaeological material, those S fibulae that I showed you. That cultural tradition moves. So we have a model for material culture. So we have two models that say, here's the story. Can we bring in another model and say, does our model correlate in any way with these models, or do we have to come up with another story? How can we reconcile or refine based on them? So we said, lumbers are the low-hanging fruit. This is one people for whom we have a once-upon-a-time story. They were here, they moved here, here, and they ended up here. And there is a material culture that the archaeologists or some archaeologists think appears in this area and moves. That's all. When we use lumber, we're hardly talking about a certain kind of material culture that represents a kind of militarized society. No idea whether these people thought they were lumbers, and someone might think that they're lumbered for political reasons, something else for social reasons. Linguistically, they may be something else. They may have multiple identities. These identities may change. The label is not indigenous. So we can build models based on genetics and the comparison. We started out with a team of historians, of geneticists, and archaeologists working together, not pulling the historians in at the end or asking the geneticists to prove our theories, but really a team to work together. And we have collected about 1,400 samples from 1,400 graves from the Czech Republic, Austria, Hungary, Italy. There's some in Slovenia that we have access to. Some of them, the archaeologists say, oh, these are lumber. Some they say, oh, these are not lumber. Well, we know these are 6th century burials. So we have a big population that we can try to take a look at. We have some specific questions. We'd like to know how to understand the social structure of these militarized communities. How are they organized? How are they organized in Pannonia, that is a Hungarian area? How are they organized in Italy? What is the structure, to the extent that we can see it in cemeteries, because the societies are gone, they were illiterate, we have no text from them. Does the structure of burial tell us something about the community? Are these people who buried the cemetery set with this special kind of burial dress, jewelry, weapons, type of grave? Are they simply part of the local population who, for whatever cultural or political reasons, represent their dead in this new way? Or does this mean, is this a group that actually has arrived in this area, and the difference between the way they bury and their neighbors bury indicates that they are coming from someplace else, and that they really are not part of the same community? And then, what about the ones in Italy and the ones in Pannonia, Hungary, Austria? Are they closely related to each other? Is there real evidence that this population has recently moved into this area? Or is there a greater genetic distance between the people buried in this way in Italy and Hungary than there is between people buried in other ways in Italy and people buried other ways in Hungary? So these are our historical questions. None of them have to do with lumber. It's just population. We have to turn them into genetic questions. So social structure, what genetic relationships exist inside of a cemetery? Can we find kinship within the cemetery? And how are other cemeteries in the area structured? Are they just part of the local population, or have they come in? Well, genetically, then, what biological relationship between these groups are discernible? And if they are related, do we see that based on mitochondria or Y chromosomal that there is a sexual bias in this? Are all the women the same, but the men form discrete groups? Or vice versa? Or is it just one big toss salad? And then Italy and Hungary, evidence of migration. Is there a genetic continuity? So very, very basic questions. They have nothing to do with political or cultural identity, just populations. Well, it would cost us millions to test 1,400 samples properly. And I don't yet have the millions, but we'll pass the hat after the lecture. So we're starting with two test cases, two very well excavated sites. One in Hungary, Solod, one in Italy near Torino, grounds of what used to be a mental hospital, but not in the 6th century millennium. Similar organization, these so-called rogue grave cemeteries, presumably early to mid-6th century. The orange are the late 6th century, and then the cemetery is used subsequently. But similar structure, similar kinds of artifacts, these kinds of fibulae, some S-shaped fibulae, but other types that show a similar cultural tradition between these two places. And so we are collecting bones from these populations. And that's another whole story about what bone and what you do with them. And we are submitting them to what is called next generation sequencing, which is the current state of the art in a very, very rapidly evolving kind of genetic analysis. There's even now a third generation sequencing, but for what we're doing, this seems to work better. We're going after 1.2 million points on the genome, single nucleotide polymorphisms, the SNPs, that have been used before to recognize minor differences in population in Europe in modern DNA that would help us to detect recent movements. Are there isolate communities? Do they fit together and so forth? Also to infer kinship, and we think that we, with decent coverage from the nuclear DNA, we can get up to second removed, second cousins within these communities to see how these people actually relate to each other. Are they related to each other? Are these recent ad hoc agglomerations, or are these interrelated long-term communities? And that is going to allow us to produce data that's similar to work being done in Germany, in Jena, at the Max Planck Institute by Johannes Krause, who's actually very kindly doing our nuclear DNA sequencing for us. Then we want to look at 155 regions of contiguous sequence in areas that are presumably not subject to major change, more random. These are the 1.2 million SNPs are chosen because people think that these are important. We want to just look at kind of general regions that would let us apply some population genetic methodologies to test possible demographic histories in relationship to what we've talked about. And then this will allow us to get data comparable to another German lab that's doing these kind of these sectors. So we're trying to begin to build a database that can be plugged into other people's research so that we can all share. These are our samples from Solod and from Colenio so far. 20 samples from each cemetery. Now we're doing all of the Solod with the National Science Foundation grant. We are trying to move forward. It's very disappointing. This is our coverage for the nuclear captures. Very, very poor success in Colenio. A little bit better in Solod, but very low coverage. That, the problem is you can graft 1.2 million SNPs. But to compare them, you want the same steps from all of the people so that you can say, oh, these are related to that. With our first pass, the coverage is so low that we're having to go back. We've learned in the last year, the genetic world has found out that there's a little bone in the end of ear called the petrous bone that has 400 times more DNA than any other part of the anatomy. A year ago, nobody knew that. We were working with teeth, everybody wants. Now we've got to go back, get the skulls, just gotten a shipment of skulls into our lab in Florence, cut out the petrous bone, and resample. So, but this is where we've gotten so far. So what are we going to do with that? Well, when we get our data, what do you do with it? What, how do we understand our material? There are basically two ways. It's unsupervised, which means testing alternative, you're not really testing hypotheses. You're eyeballing data. You're looking primarily at individuals, and it's a preliminary exploration. That's basically where we are thus far with our nuclear DNA work. You can generate some hypotheses, but it's not there yet. This is an example from, these are the nuclear captures from Solod and Colenio, which we have been plotted on the kind of map that you saw before, John November's type map. This is a modern European DNA map. And the little boxes, this is Colenio, this is Solod. These are the our samples. You plot them on the map, and then you plug in our samples to see where they fit. Now, we're not, you shouldn't think about who is in, these people are in Bulgaria. No, they're not in Bulgaria or Spain, but sort of generally, is there any kind of clustering? What does it look like on European map? Let's take a look a little bit. These are the individuals. The pink ones are the ones that we've been able to get DNA from. Very frustrating. There's some others I'm really curious about. We hope that when we get the skulls open, they will talk to us. Let's take a look at the unsupervised data analysis of Solon, just to give you an idea. Here's Solon with these diamonds are the samples that we have been able to plot with the European, modern European map. And
you can see that most of them cluster, well, this would be the Czech Republic and, you know, sort of northern central Europe. They kind of belong more or less where they ought to be. And they're kind of together. And then we have these two outliers. Well, one is Bulgaria, the other is Spain. Trust me, they're not from Bulgaria or Spain. There's no such thing as Bulgarians at this point. There's no such thing as Spaniards at this point. But they are outliers from the large group. Well, they're a genetic outlier for that group. What might that mean? Well, who are they in the cemetery? So we go back and look at our cemetery. This is where the archaeologists are very important and say, aha, these two people who are our outliers are also outliers where they're buried. They're buried on the periphery of the cemetery. One is a man, one is a woman. All of these others, though, pretty much all of the men and the women are buried with weapons for the men, elaborate jewelry for the women. They got nothing. Maybe one little iron belt buckle on the man. Otherwise, the grave goods suggest they're really different from the rest of the population. So, okay, well, how about the graves themselves? These are the different depths of graves. And these graves, the archaeologists identify as this particular cultural type of graves, are often 3 meters deep or even more. I mean, these are really, and they're wooden buildings underground, in a sense. But not these two. These two are among the shallowest graves. There are a few children's graves around this woman. So we have peripheral to the cemetery, different kind of burial structure, different kind of material culture, margin to the cemetery, beginning to think these people may be different in somehow. Now we could start thinking about what that difference might be, and that would be a real mistake. That's where we begin making up stories about our data. We need to find out about the other people in the cemetery. We need to find out about adjacent cemeteries. Do they look like people who are buried in the area, who are not buried in this kind of rich weapon and jewelry-rich cemeteries, which might suggest they're locals and these others are not? If they're very different from anybody else in the area, maybe they've come in from the outside. You could know. All kinds of hypotheses. Oh, they're Roman captives. They're slaves. Or when we do the carbon 14 testing, we find out that they're later. Maybe they have nothing to do with this community. We don't know yet. But we can begin to see through our genetic data, when compared with archaeological, that there is something here. And when we do all 1,400, we'll have some better idea. But we don't really have a coherent story to tell, and we would be very wrong to start jumping in and explaining it the way some, unfortunately, otherwise very fine geneticists have done with their data. To say, oh, well, these must be whatever, and then you tell your story. What we really want to do is to get to model-based approaches. That is, testing models against each other. Usually these are whole populations and not just individuals. And we can then see which model, when we plug in our real data, which model most closely approximates our data, which can actually give us probability. We can't say it is more probable that these people are from Italy than that they are from the region. We can't say that yet. But this is the kind of modeling that we need to do. And we have to get these models then in part from the archaeologists and from the historians. It's a truly interdisciplinary operation. One example that we did, a very simple one that we published last year, is looking at the graves of these 6th century cemeteries in Piedmont in Italy with a very basic question. Are these the ancestors of a contemporary population or not? And we have two models. One, 55 generations ago were these people, and today they are the local population. The other, there's no relationship. Very, very crude, simple test. So then we run 50,000 simulations of what the results would be, or what the results might be given different population sizes and different histories of both of those populations, you know, those possibilities, with the red being direct continuity, the blue being no continuity. And when we do this, we find in this area, after we do 50,000 simulations, if we take our actual data, which we plug in, that's a little yellow dot that you can barely see in each one of these, and it turns out that maybe there's some continuity here. Otherwise, these people are not the ancestors of the local population. That statistically, it is highly unlikely that there is continuity. It's not just making up a story. It doesn't work. Which raises questions for me about all of these sophisticated studies taking modern DNA and saying, oh, well, now we understand European population migration. Seems that people actually move around a lot more. Genetic lines die out, things get mixed up, and this is a kind of real test of the possibility of doing modern DNA and extrapolating back. And we find with this kind of testing, it doesn't work. But then we can have to test these models with other kind of models. One thing we've been doing very briefly is isotopic analysis. That is carbon, strontium, oxygen that are picked up in bones and teeth at different ages to see, you know, what can we say about diet, what can we say about possibly the strontium is picked up in children. So did the person die where they're born? Is the signal of the strontium in the water and the soil similar to that which you find in the people's skeletons, which means that maybe they were born and died there, or is it different, meaning that they came from someplace else? We don't know where they came from, but are they indigenous or exotic? If we look at solon, in here, this is the signal from the water and the soil at solon. And the only people who were born and died in solon as children. The men and the women pretty much come from someplace else. But the women, their parameter is much wider than the men. It looks like the women are coming from all over. The men come from someplace else, but they pretty much come from the same place. Which raises some interesting questions about migration, about sexually differentiated population society that one has to consider. It might be that, okay, they're not local, men are less diverse. Seems to correlate also with the mitochondria that we have an enormous variety. They're all traditional European haplogroups, but there are no two who are exactly the same haplogroup in this village. Carbon, look at the diets of Colegno and Hungarian diets, people in Italy, they're eating Italian food. They've not, if they've migrated, they've not brought their Pannonian diet with them, because maybe they're local. The diets are different. If there's a migration, there is a cultural change. This is the strontium and collenio. There are just a few outliers. This is the main two. It looks to be pretty much local. Basically, we have a few and one who's way the heck off the map. Looking at it in a different way, it's much tighter profile. Looks like these people may be buried with the kind of weapons and jewelry you find in Pannonia, but it looks like they're local people. These are the graves that we're looking at, these high strontium, just these yellow ones, and then particularly low green You can then make up stories, you know, maybe a couple of founders, then there are others who founders, different diet, similar equipment, then there are local people close to them with a similar diet. You can see how the society changes. One individual has a very high non-local strontium signal from someplace way the heck off. Where, we don't know. We don't have a good map of strontium because strontium depends on the soil type across Europe. And so you can have the same soil type that's hundreds of miles away. You can also have a different soil type just a few kilometers. So when someone is not from the place, you know, it's from 1,000 miles away or 5 miles. You know, this one outlier seems to, one area that connects with is beginning to do strontium maps of Europe. There's a high signal there from the Eastern Alps and Hungary. Maybe, but could also be from lots of other places. But it might correlate with where the written texts say that this population comes from, but it's just very, very hypothetical at this point. So what is all this going to teach us? Well, because of the ideology, because of the arguments, the most important thing is what we're not going to learn. We're not going to know who these people really were. The idea of identity is a very, very slippery issue. And identity is not a fixed, stable, universal. We're not going to know who the real lumbers are. That is not a genetic question. We won't know which Italians today are descendants of lumbers because we don't know who the lumbers were. It's not going to tell us if the barbarian invasions destroyed the Roman Empire. It's not going to tell the European Union how to adjust their migration and immigration and refugee policies. If we could do that, they would fund us. And if we could guarantee the results that the governments want, they would give us even more money. We might find out the structure of the communities. We might find out whether these are simply indigenous populations that have taken on different cultural roles. We may find out whether there is continuity between the two areas. It's hard. Getting sequence data is very difficult. I hope we get, when we crack these new skulls open. We had to crack some skulls to get permission to crack the skulls. And now we've got them. And now we need to see what we can get out of them. Developing the models that we're going to apply, this is not off-the-shelf mathematics. So we really have to develop algorithms and approaches to deal with this data. International cross-disciplinary collaboration, educating geneticists and historians and archaeologists to really work together, because we speak different languages, but we use the same vocabulary, and we mean radically different things. The geneticists still say, well, tell us which are the lumbers. But we can't tell you that. And the historians want to know everything about this person and this grave, and we can't do that. So we have a lot of meetings. We just had one in Vienna, bring everybody together. Have some wine, make the geneticists listen to historians, and vice versa. It's a challenge to understand what the different disciplines can do, and especially what they can't do, but how we need each other. Finding €3 million that I need to finance it, that's why we're all here. What do we get? Maybe a model of how to do this sort of work. I don't care about lumbers. Whether or not they ever existed. But I'm interested in developing with a good case study how to do this. Also, developing a model for how we work together, which is sadly something that is missing because humanists tend to say, we read texts. Archaeologists say, we dig. And geneticists say, we sequence. And that is dividing us and preventing us from understanding the complexity of the past. I also hope this will contribute to what will someday be an ancient DNA database like John Lefebvre's wonderful modern database to explain, look at Europe and beyond to Asia, because Eurasia is There are important population movements from Central Asia, west as well as east. Would it be wonderful to have a 6th century map, a genetic map of all of Eurasia? Begin to get an sense of diversity. This is not giving us essential evidence, but you're giving evidence of diversity. Estimating numbers of migrants. Is this just a small military group coming in? Or are there larger groups of population? How much do they interact with the indigenous population? How quickly do they fall for those Italian girls? Or do they maintain not only cultural separation, but a marital policy? I started estimating the lasting demographic impact, if there is any, of these populations. And probably what will never happen is separating contemporary politics from all of this. That, I fear, is hopeless. But I hope that we'll have a better understanding of heterogeneity, complexity, and malleability of Europe's population, not just in the past, but sense of how history works, because ultimately history is not studying a moment in the past or looking for essences that have been transferred to the present. It's a study of differential change in human society over time. And it is that heterogeneity, complexity, transformative nature of humans that excites me and makes me do this. These are some of the people who are the key in this process. From across Europe, we have Germans, Hungarians, Czechs, Italians, Americans, British involved in it, and we have bits of funding from these institutions to whom I am forever grateful. Thank you very much.